Hey guys, so I'm continuing to pull out quotes from this book, 12 Years a Slave, and just being really moved again by some of the most awful moments that Solomon Northup has to deal with, being sold into slavery, because, you know, having been born a free man, he's captured, kidnapped, and sold into slavery. Anyway, continuing, this is page 97 on my iPad. It was about a short time I closed my eyes at night. Thought was busy in my brain. Could it be possible that I was thousands of miles from home? That I'd been driven through the streets like a dumb beast? That I'd been chained and beaten without mercy? That I was even then herded with a drove of slaves, a slave myself? Were the events of the last few weeks realities indeed? Or was I passing only through the dismal phases of a long, protracted dream? It was no illusion. My cup of sorrow was full to overflowing. Then I lifted up my hands to God, and in the still watches of the night, surrounded by the sleeping forms of my companions, begged for mercy on the poor, forsaken captive. To the Almighty Father of us all, the free man and the slave, I pour forth the supplications of a broken spirit, imploring strength from on high to bear up against the burden of my troubles, until the morning light aroused the slumbers, ushering in another day of bondage. Like I said, I just feel like sometimes I read this, no commentary is necessary, because just, wow. Okay, next quote. Let that sink in for a while. Oof. I reread this part. I think it's the one. So this next quote. He would make us hold up our heads, walk briskly back and forth, while customers would feel up our hands and arms and bodies, turn us about, ask us what we could do, make us open their mouths and show our teeth, precisely as a jockey examines a horse which he's about to barter for our purchase. Sometimes a man or woman has taken back to the small house in the yard, stripped and inspected more minutely. Scars upon a slave's back were considered evidence of a rebellious or unruly spirit and heard his sale. So, yeah, they're just looked about as products. It's so humiliating and dehumanizing and just all that. It's just like these are not looked as people, but just products and property to be sold and looked at and evaluated. Next quote. All the time the trade was going on, Eliza was crying aloud and wringing her hands. She besought the man not to buy him unless he also bought herself and Emily. She promised, in that case, to be the most faithful slave that ever lived. The man answered that he could not afford it. And then Eliza burst into a paroxysm of grief, weeping plaintively. Freeman turned round to her savagely, with his whip in his uplifted hand, offering her to stop her noise or he would flog her. Next quote. A great many times she repeated her former promises, how very faithful and obedient she would be. How hard she would labor every day and night to the last moment of her life if he would only buy them all together. But it was of no avail. The man could not afford it. The bargain was agreed upon, and Randall must go alone. Then Eliza ran to him, embraced him passionately, kissed him again and again, told him to remember her, all the while her tears falling in the boy's face like rain. So, this is the only thing that Eliza cares about is not really being sold as slave, but she wants to be together with her family in being sold as slaves, as they're being auctioned off by these people. But unfortunately, the guy who's buying Eliza's son, Randall, is not able to afford her son and her and Emily. So they cannot go together. And this is how the family gets separated and torn apart. What has become the lad, Randall? God knows. It was a mournful scene indeed. I would have cried myself if I had dared. Here we go. Next quote. These are all very serious quotes. I'm getting very tearful here. I expected to die. There was little in the prospect before me worth living for. The near approach of death appalled me. I thought I could have been resigned to yield up my life in the bosom of my family. But to expire in the midst of strangers under such circumstances was a bitter reflection. So even as a slave, you know, there is still this desire to die, not because he has anything to live for, but because death in that situation was such to be a pitiful death. It would be a relief if I could consistently pass over in silence the scene that now ensued. It recalls memories more mournful and affecting than any language can portray. I've seen mothers kissing for the last time the faces of their dead offspring. I've seen them looking down into the grave as the earth fell with a dull sound upon their coffins, hiding them from their eyes forever. But never have I seen such an exhibition of intense, unmeasured, and unbounded grief as when Eliza was parted from her child. She broke from her place in the line of women, and rushing down where Emily was standing, caught her in her arms. The child, sensible of some impending danger, instinctively fastened her hands around her mother's neck and nestled her little head upon her bosom. Freeman sternly ordered her to be quiet, but she did not heed him. He caught her by the arm and pulled her rudely, but she only clung the closer to the child. Then, with a volley of great oaths, he struck her such a heartless blow that she staggered backward and was like to fall. Oh, how piteously then did she beseech and beg and pray that they might not be separated. Why could they not be purchased together? Why not let her have one of her dear children? Mercy, mercy, master, she cried, falling on her knees. Please, master, buy Emily. I can never work any if she is taken from me. I will die. I will continue, next quote. The man remarked he was not in need of one, so young. They would be of no profit to him. But since the mother was so fond of her, rather than see them separated, he would pay a reasonable price. But to this humane proposal, Freeman was entirely deaf. He would not sell her, then, on any account whatever. There were heaps and piles of money to be made of her, he said, when she was a few years older. There were men enough in New Orleans who would give $5,000 for such an extra handsome fancy piece as Emily would be, rather than not get her. No, no, he would not sell her then. She was a beauty, a picture, a doll, one of the regular bloods. None of your thick-lipped, bullet-headed, cotton-picking niggers. If she was, he'd be damned. Now, I use the N-word. I know that might be offensive. I just read what was written. I don't mean to actually say that myself, but that's what was written there. It's important to note that, you know, in a book like this, written in the 1840s and 1830s, a long time ago, the N-word is used like this. But when it says she might be, well, she might as well be damned, damned is actually censored. It's D-D. It's pretty interesting that damned is considered profanity, but the N-word is used fully here. And I'm just going to be reading them as is, just to give you the full kind of gravity, the weight of the times. It was a very offensive time, you know. I'm not going to shy away from the fact that it was a very offensive time. A horrible time. Horrible experience and moment. For Eliza, for Solomon, you know, she's so desperate here that she doesn't get separated from her daughter. And Freeman, this guy who is auctioning off these slaves, doesn't care. It's all about profit. You know, Eliza will grow up a little bit older. Emily. And she'll be much more valuable to sell later on than right now. You know, so why would I sell her now? Eliza never after saw or heard of Emily or Randall. Day nor night, however, were they ever absent from her memory. In the cotton field, in the cabin, always and everywhere. She was talking of them, often to them, as if they were actually present. Only when absorbed in that illusion, or asleep, did she ever have a moment's comfort afterwards. I'm going to end it there. I think this is tough stuff, man, this book. Tough stuff.